Hey guys, thanks for tuning in. Check it out. It finally came in yesterday, as a matter of fact. It just came in. Today's Father's Day. And what a great surprise. For Father's Day, I'm able to review the DJI Spark. We're going to be reviewing this thing, doing a full review if we can, unboxing, inspecting, setting up, doing a thorough flight test. This is the Fly More Combo, so it's got the controller, extra batteries, all that stuff. So we're going to go in depth with this one and also see if it works with some accessories I got for the Mavic. And see how that all works. Here's some range extenders. And we're also gonna do a quick little comparison to the Mavic. Here's the Mavic here, and we're gonna put them up against each other just to see how they look in comparison and do a full review. So let's get started. So here it is, nothing super special about the box as far as DJI goes. It's a pretty plain Jane box, just gives you a picture of the Spark right on front. And then just some details in the back, which is a little bit washed out right now because of the brightness of this camera. But let's just dig right in. I'm just going to unbox it real quick and take everything out, and then we'll get started with the review. So first off, check it out. This version from DJI comes with a 16 gig. So you get a 16 gig SanDisk memory card with the purchase right now. If you purchase through the link I have in the description, at DJI, they'll throw in that card for you. Further digging into the box, you can see that here's what we got. We got the main box. This is what the Spark's gonna be in. This looks like what the charger is gonna be in, and then this is all the other stuff. A nice case they're giving us here. Let me pull this out. Let me take everything out, and then we'll put the box on the side. So there's the case. This looks like the Spark here. Nice EP foam case. Looks like they give you quite a bit of reading material. Look at this stack of books. So we got one pamphlet for the Fly More Combo, remote controller, a Spark in general. That's the thickest one there. Definitely has a lot of different languages, and that's why it's so thick. Here's another one for the Spark, quick start guide, remote controller C2, battery charging hub. Since this is the Fly More Combo, we get all this extra stuff in here. Propeller guards instruction book, just for that. Wow. And then the DJI Care refresh thing, you can get extra. I would recommend the refresh. I didn't have it on the first Mavic that I lost and drowned. And that really kind of bit me in the butt, because I would have been able to get a new Mavic if I had the refresh. But anyway, that's a big old stack of instructions there. We're gonna put that on the side, read that a little bit later before we go out and fly it. So cool. Let's just go ahead and get into the main Spark package real quick. And just wanted to kind of show you a little bit on how they're packaging this. It looks like it is kind of like, you remember their Phantom 4 series, how it has actually the case is a foam case. This is basically a shaped EP foam case, and the thing that kind of struck me was there's a little bit of pock marking, like it wasn't molded completely perfect and smooth for some reason. So the finish, you know, I would have expected more, a little bit more from DJI, so maybe they need to work on their molding for the case just a little bit, so we don't get this little bit of aeration pock marks when they're molding the foam. But that's it, that's the case for the Spark. It's just got this little kind of plastic hinge here in the back. And it's just locked in just like that. Just a little bit of pressure locks there, and we open up. We've got some nice padding here, and there it is. So I got the white version, and there's all different kind of colors you can get if you wanted a better color. Actually, this, they only had white when I ordered mine, so that's why I have a white here. I probably would have gotten a different color, but white's fine. Definitely reflect the sun, keep it cool when flying. And you can see what we get here. We get a battery within the case, and then we have another battery, empty battery pack there. Just pop out the battery here, and let's take a look at the battery real quick first. We can see we have a couple of contact areas. I think that's for the charging, and there's where it connects into the craft. So it is a little bit hard to see there with the wording in the camera, but not sure you're gonna be able to see that, but it is a 1480 milliamp hour, 11.4 volt. So it's a little bit of a high voltage 3S battery, a little higher than normal proprietary It's got these little spring-loaded slide locks here on both sides, and this looks like part of the stand. This is actually a rubberized material on the bottom of the battery. And then we just have a little bit of a grip there, nothing much on that side. Then on the front, we just have this little stick-on, little warning thing, charge the battery first to power off and on. So it may not even power on until we charge the battery. But there's a little power indicator. If we push it once, we should be able to see the power of the battery. And this one's not even showing up anything. So it looks like they're actually in the smart software of the battery. They're doing kind of a making sure you charge it thing first. So you can't even turn on the battery for the first use unless you charge it all the way up. So that's actually a good thing, so that you don't ruin the battery in the first cycle and not charge it. Anyway, that's the battery. We've got a set of blades here in this box. We got actually two sets, and let's see what we get. I'm just gonna pop open one just so you see. They kind of just slide through here. So there's actually two in here. So you're gonna get a whole new set total in this box. And these are just like the folding propellers, very similar to the Mavic, but smaller. And then they have a little bit of a different locking mechanism. You can see where they have these tabs that push down and lock. So we'll be exploring that in just a second. Okay, so there's the propellers, and then here is the spark. Here it is. So the first thing that catches your eye on the spark is just how small it is. Here's a hand. I mean, I'm like a guy that's about 6'1", and there it is in my hand. It's pretty darn small. I can touch my fingers around the center here. And here it is compared to like a 5.5 inch phone. It's pretty much the main size of the body is about the same size of it. The phone's quite a bit wider though. The thing that catches my eye is why the heck didn't they make the arms fold in some way? Because you can't really put this in your pocket. If they would have made the arms fold back and forward, guess what? You could fit this in, you know, kind of a large baggy pocket, and you wouldn't have to have a case with it, but they chose not to do that. Maybe for vibration reasons, who knows? Anyway, this is how it is. It's got this really high impact, sturdy plastic here. Here's the two axis gimbal. So it's not a three axis, it's a two axis. So we have an up and down pitch stabilization and also a roll stabilization. You can see it rolling here. And while we're at the camera here, let's take off this little protective coating there. And this is not 4K, so keep in mind, this is not a 4K camera. Would have been really nice if they could have incorporated a little mini 4K camera, kind of like some of the other drones out have in this bracket. But this does not have 4K, but the 1080p is supposed to be pretty well stabilized. Here's the front sensor. So this is gonna be your obstacle avoidance and also facial recognition type of sensor for controlling it with your hand. Looks like it's got all kinds of sensors in there. I can only see a couple. Looks like infrared sensors and stuff, and some lasers possibly to bounce off of you to keep its distance from you. And here's those propellers that we were talking about. We just push it in. It's spring-loaded, so it's popping up nice and easy. And I'm twisting counterclockwise for this one, and boom. Super simple. You can see the spring in there and all the hardware that goes with it. So all you're doing is matching up the little slots, putting the main shaft through the top, and then twisting one way and popping it back up. And that thing's not going anywhere. It's locked in there nice and tight. It's got indication for clockwise and counterclockwise. You can see the little ring of white there. And then these ones don't have any. Little itty bitty motors. Looks like they're very similar in size, a little bit smaller though than the Mavic motors. Speaking of the Mavic, I got the Mavic right here. Let's just do a quick little comparison in size. So there's the Mavic right next to it, and here's what the Spark looks like right on top. You can see that the Mavic is quite a bit bigger, especially when we extend the arms. The Mavic is going to be much bigger. Let's just do that really quick so you can just see the overall size. But when the Mavic is actually closed up, it's actually not that much bigger. But let's just have all the arms extended and give it a good little comparison. So there we go. So you can see how much longer the Mavic arms stick out compared to the Spark. And if we kind of line up the back of the Mavic, there it is. You can kind of see how much larger it is that way. And then let's get a good shot of the front. See how much thicker and bigger the Mavic is. Let me slide this up to the front. Kind of get it lined up perfectly. There we go. So there's the Spark compared to the Mavic right there. There's a good shot of it. Okay, so that's what we can expect. And you can see how on the Spark, the landing gear are right on the bottom. They don't touch the arms at all. So the ground's only going to be touching the bottom of the Spark. And on the Mavic, the landing gear is on the front arms, and then the rear is on the back here. Anyway, let's go ahead and put our trusty Mavic over here on the side. We'll be touching base with that guy a little bit later. And let's continue on with the Spark. So a cute little gimbal here. It feels like it is kind of rubber stabilized up in there, kind of like how the Mavic is. It's got some kind of little rubber grommets for vibration. And here's the landing feet. We already checked out the one on the battery, the other battery, but really good, nice and durable, thick feeling rubber down here. You can see how it's quite pliable. Really grippy rubber there. And here's our bottom sensors. So there's a camera there, and then I'm not sure if these are sonic or cameras as well. It might just be using like a 3D camera system here, where we have three different cameras, but they do only look like cameras, not sonic sensors. And then this is the battery that comes on it. The way we're taking this battery off, it looks like it's just pulling both of these to the back. Wow, and then it just slips right off. So you don't have to pull up or anything. It's actually just sliding right in. Let's try to see that again. Pushing and snapping that way. And then to pull it off, just make sure you pull these back and the whole thing will just pull off. So a pretty cool system, nice and easy. It looks like this thing actually does pop up, yeah. So this is actually the cover, so that's not gonna light up. It's the cover for the micro SD card and where you can plug in a micro USB cable in there. So pretty neat. I like how they have that right there, easily accessible. So that's basically it in a nutshell. The only other thing we haven't looked at are the bottoms of the motors, and there's our lighting rings. So pretty neat, easy to see from all different angles. You can see that lighting ring there, and from the bottom, should be able to see the lighting really good at night and in low light. So anyhow, that's the Spark, guys. Let's open up this bag, the Flymore combo bag, and see what comes in there. Okay, the Flymore combo bag. This is what I paid the extra couple hundred dollars for. It's got a nice big strap here, so you can carry it like a camera bag. So a neat looking top. Feels really rugged, real durable. It's like a faux leather, but it's like rubberized, so it feels very, very durable. There's no pockets on the side here. It's got one of those like really high grip, like durable rubberized bottoms, so setting it down won't like puncture it or anything. And it's got like this two-tone kind of like fabric and this faux leather plastic wrap around the whole case, making it look really durable and feel very durable. So it's kind of well hidden, but there's our front pocket, and let's see what they stuck in. Micro USB cable to USB, looks like for updating and stuff if you need to. And what's this? Oh, cool. So there's our charge hub. So you can put three batteries in it, since this is the Flymore combo. These are all the extra things. Looks like we're putting in the power there, power port for our power plug. And it does have this little plastic, this little rubber cap here. Let me see if I can pull this off. That's a micro USB port. So it looks like you can, if you want to, use this cable to plug into a computer or cell phone plug. And if you wanted to charge your batteries, it's probably going to take a while because it's not going to be much amperage going into the battery, but you can charge it with a USB plug as well. If you're not in a rush, it'll take a long time, but you have that option. That's pretty cool. So that's everything in the front pocket. And now let's get into the main pocket. Unzip the top, open this up. Cool. So first thing I'm noticing is a little elastic fold over. There's no zipper here, but you get a little mesh pocket there, see-through pocket, and we have this little foam there on top, this little Decasent silica pack, and here's the controller, another little foam protector. Cool, so check this out, look a little similar. That's because it's almost identical to, this is the Mavic controller on the right here, and here's a Spark controller on the left. So very similar, all they did was, looks like they changed the micro USB port from regular USB on the Mavic, and the bottom arms look very similar, almost exactly the same how they come in. There is no screen, as you can see, and they put the sport button on the front. They've got pause here, a function button there. This one has a little joystick, so that's different. And it looks like they have the battery level power. Let's see if we just push the power button. Yeah, so it's half charged right now. There's our battery level. We have a designated return to home button there. Very similar to the Mavic, same thing. And the antenna system looks almost exactly the same. Looks like we're missing one roller, so we don't have that right, like we could adjust our EV setting with this right roller here on the Mavic. Looks like we replaced that with a button there. But the other two buttons look the same. We have camera and recording on here. So very, very similar. Looks like a little bit of a different venting than the mesh on the Mavic was. And the back looks very similar as well. No triggers. The Mavic has these two trigger buttons here, but this one doesn't have any trigger buttons. So those are the main differences, and the antennas look almost exactly the same. You see the antennas, and it's also the same fold and clip system as the Mavic, where you just pull them apart. They have a little click notch where they click together in here, and you can store it away nicely. And yeah, same exact type of feel as the Mavic on the antennas. So that's kind of cool. Actually, we might be able to put on the Mavic range extenders. Let me see if I can put on these parabolic dishes. Feels maybe, yeah, it'll go on. It's a little, like a tiny bit thicker, but it feels like I can push them on. You see that there? They are sliding down in, but a little bit tighter compared to the Mavic one. So there might be a tad bit of difference in the dimension of the antenna casing. Fold them in, push them down a snap, and those won't unsnap. Let's just take off this plastic here. I always like just peeling off the new plastic guards, see what's underneath. So there it is, the Spark controller, pretty cool. Might as well open these guys up real quick and just show you that they're very similar to the Mavic. It's almost exactly the same kind of mechanism. Only difference I'm seeing here is the micro USB ports there. And oh yeah, on the side too, on the Mavic controller, you can see that that's where you connect the cable to your phone or tablet too. This one doesn't have that. So this one just has this connection right there. Check this out. I bought this extra little attachment for a big iPad. You can hook this on in where the phone goes, and it brings this arm out, and you can put a big like iPad on it. And let's just see really quick while we're at it. Let's just see if this thing fits in here. So in case I wanted to use this also, awesome, it does. So it fits perfectly, and then we can go ahead and put our tablet right here and have our big tablet interface if we wanted to fly like that. Of course, not quite as portable, but you do have the option to use one of those Mavic extensions, and it seems like it fits perfectly, just like the Mavic. Great to know. Okay, so before we get too sidetracked, here's how you fold the thing back in, just like the Mavic. There's the controller. Let's go a little bit further into the bag and see what else is in here. So here's the charger. So check this thing out. So it looks very similar to the Mavic charger. That's where we're gonna have our power cable. I'm just gonna pull all this stuff out and we'll go through it. The pockets actually have bottoms in the pockets, so it's separate than the bottom of the bag. And the bag does have this nice little padding separator here to separate things how you see fit. It's a little kind of foldy little separator. While we're at it, what do you say we just see if we can fit the Mavic in here? I know this bag looks kind of small, but in a pinch, say you have both the Mavic and the Spark. And what if you want to take the Mavic? Yes, it does. So look at that. So you could fit your Mavic in. Also, the Mavic's not going to stand up like this. You're going to have to put the Mavic in sideways like this. But the Mavic does go pretty far down in there, and you have quite a bit of space on top, so you could probably fit your controller and possibly squeeze in a couple batteries and use this bag as your Mavic bag as well. So that's pretty cool. So I'm just opening this bag up. This looks like prop guards. Cool. So you do get a set of prop guards. So there's four prop guards, two in each bag. And let's just see how these things go on. And with these guys, I'm not seeing any indication of what's, you know, front or back or left or right. So it looks like they're all the same. So it looks like on these, just kind of like push it up into the bottom of the motor like this while the clamp is over on the back. And then you just slide it. See if I can get some better lighting on this. Slide it just like so. So we're on the bottom of the motor, sliding over the arm, and then boom. Shut the clip and you hear that little click, and that's on. So that's how you put your prop guards on. Pretty simple. Take it off, undo the clip, slide it that way, and push it down. And there's your prop guards. I doubt I'm going to be using these. If you're going to be flying in your house and doing some stuff, or really close to things or people, maybe use these prop guards. But rule of thumb, prop guards are going to give you less flight time because they're more weight, and they're also going to give you more drag in the wind. So it looks like with the Spark here, the plug they give us with this Flymore combo, you can't actually directly plug this plug into the battery. You actually have to use either the Flymore battery pack. See how we plug that in there, and then slip your battery right onto the charger like that. It clicks in nice and tight. You take the USB adapter they gave us, and you plug it into, you see the power adapter here? It's got actually two regular size USBs to it. So this is the way you're gonna be charging your controller. We take the other end of the controller cable, and we put it in right here. And it looks to me like we can also charge the Spark just by doing this. So you'll have a battery on the Spark, plug this in here, and it seems like that's the way you're going to charge the Spark without having this extra battery hub charger. And then of course with the same cable, if you didn't want to use that there and all you had access to was a portable power battery or something, or a computer, or something that just uses the USB, this is where you're gonna plug in. That, like we talked about earlier, this is where you're gonna plug in that USB cable. It's gonna be a slower rate, but that's how you charge your batteries through USB. So I think that kinda goes through everything. There's really nothing else here, guys. I know it's a mess now on the table, but let me go ahead and charge up these batteries, charge up the controller. We'll get the Spark on screen on either the phone or this iPad tablet, and see how it looks and see what the options are before we go ahead and fly it. Okay guys, so I got everything charged up. Controller has a full charge. These two batteries have a full charge. So we're gonna connect this to a mobile device and see how it is just to connect and everything. I will say that actually in the charging hub, the two batteries actually charge at the same time. So it looks like three batteries will all charge at the same time. And that's different than the Mavic. The Mavic had to charge one each, and also the Phantom 4, you know, move to the next one. But this one actually charges all three at the same time, which is cool. Anyway, let's go ahead and link all this up. And what I need to do actually is install this little micro SD card. So I'm just gonna open up the package that they put it in here and install this. I don't know if you guys can see that, but it looks like this section, the notch section, is going to go on the left. The contact part is actually going to be facing up. Okay, so just pushing it in, and then you're going to feel, you can hear that little click, and it's going to be in like that. That's all we need to do, just push back the door closed. And here's how we connect it to the controller. So initially I had thought that this was going to be the plug to also connect to your cell phone, kind of like the Mavic does, but I was wrong. It actually just has a wireless connection through your Wi-Fi wireless network. It creates its own network between the phone and the controller, and then this connects directly to the craft from the controller. So what it's saying first to do is connect your, turn your controller on, and then that'll put out a Wi-Fi signal, and then you connect your cell phone to it through the DJI Go 4 app. So we'll do that real quick. The first thing you wanna do is open up the antennas, do the infamous DJI power on by just going ahead and pressing once and then pressing and holding. So we hear the beep up. We don't want to turn on the craft first. First we want to go into our cell phone, and we want to go into our wireless network. So I'm connected to my home Wi-Fi right now, but I want to look for the Spark, and there's a Spark down there. You can see it, Spark, with some information. Actually the Spark controller, it said RC there. And punch in the password. It's saying on mine it's just 123412234. I'd imagine that's a default password for all of them. So punch that in, press connect, and obtaining an IP address, and we're connected to the Spark RC. Great. Of course, the internet's unavailable because we're just connecting directly to the controller. So I'm gonna close that, and then we're gonna open up our DJI 4 app, Go 4 app. So opening that up, and now is when we wanna turn on the Spark. The back power, we're just pressing it once, and then pressing and holding it again till all the lights go up. So I'm gonna do that facing the camera so you can kind of see how the whole thing starts up. So pressing once, pressing and holding, letting go. Let's see what the camera does. Cool. So you saw the camera just go face forward and initialize. And it looks like that's all we got to do for the boot up. I'm hearing the fan spin up in the spark. Well, that's cool. Let's see what's on our screen here. So we have terms of use. Okay, agree. Activate spark. So this is where we're going to activate it. Aircraft name. I'm just going to call this Spark 1. Okay, continue. And this is running through, just like all the DJI devices, we're running through the regular stuff. I want to have mode 2 for control. You can change that here if you want, between 1, 2, and 3. Continue. I'm in the US for feet and miles, so I'm going to do imperial. Of course, you can change it to metric if you wanted to. And I'm going to turn off beginner mode. Looks like beginner mode here is indicating that it's going to limit you to a geofence of 98 feet high and 98 feet away from you. So I'm going to turn that off. That's if you're a super beginner, leave that on. So if it goes and hits those limits, it'll fly back to you. Enable advanced gesture control. When enabled, you will be able to use palm launch, palm land, and palm control. I want to enable this. And then it gives you a little bit of an information here on how to use gesture control. Okay, don't know how to get out of this screen, so let's see. Okay, I just swiped up from the bottom. Continue. Setting, activate. Check your internet connection and activation process requires internet access to link your aircraft to the account. Okay. Wi-Fi use. Okay. Okay, it's not letting me press continue because obviously it can't activate because my Wi-Fi on here is connected to the craft. And for some reason, it's not using my cellular data. So it's throwing up this activate, check your internet connection. So again, these are always the funny little loopholes problems that you find with DJI products where it's has to use the connection on your internet. So what I'm gonna do is quickly just disconnect from the Spark and connect to my home Wi-Fi. Go back out of here. These are all the little stupid confusing things I hate when activating their products. Let's just go activate now. It's acquiring activation info. So if you have this problem, just remember, go back onto your home Wi-Fi and do that. For some reason, I'm not sure why I did that. Okay, good. And you got two options here, tutorials for beginners, which I kind of am to this craft, but not in flying in general. Update firmware, and then you can check or uncheck to help DJI help improve its products, and you're probably gonna be sending information. So I'm gonna try to update firmware real quick. Let's see what this is all about. Looks like it does need an update, and it tells you a log here of all the information. It improved stuff like gesture control, and then, yeah, it's got all these updated. DJI is really good at restricting all their stuff. So this looks like updated no-fly zones. You're limited to a height of 30 meters and 50 meters distance when you're not logged into your account. So if you want to use this thing to its fullest potential, you have to have a DJI account, which is frustrating, but that's the new kind of regulations they set on their stuff. I'm going to go ahead and do it. You know, I do already have a DJI account. I need to connect to the network. Okay, what does this mean? Connect to the network. Does that mean I have to go? Okay, so the Spark reconnected automatically when I did that. So I've got to go back to my wireless network, connect. Okay, get back out of here. And then once I'm connected to my home Wi-Fi, download. I don't know why it can't just use my cell data for this. I have cell data in the house. Seems like it should know that and just automatically use that while it's connected. So that's downloading that new update. I'm gonna go ahead and download that and install it. That was a quick little download. Starting update. Connect the aircraft to or remote controller if you have one and confirm the aircraft battery level is 50%. Next. So you see how that's popping up because it's not connected to the aircraft. So now I have to go back to my Wi-Fi, back to the Spark controller, connect. And now we're connected back to the Spark RC. No internet warning, yes I know. Back out of here, and now start update. There we go. So now it's going from here to the controller, through the controller to the Spark and doing its update. So this looks like it's gonna take a while, guys. So let me let this run its course and I'll get back to you when it's done. Okay guys, wow, that took so long. I had to go get a grapefruit cocktail. Here we are at 99% on the update. I did hear it reboot a couple times. So about 15, 20 minutes for this thing. So if you're gonna be flying, don't do an update before you fly or else you're gonna eat up half your battery just doing an update. But as you can see, it's 99%. I'm just waiting for the final say in completion. I guess I'm gonna have to power everything down and then I'll start this again and see if it works. Okay, so I just rebooted everything and just went straight into the DJI Go 4 app after rebooting the controller and the Spark. And it's saying that there is new firmware available for the remote controller, so I'm just going to go ahead and do what it tells me to do. So I'm just going to download this, install this, start update, connect to remote controller. Okay, so now we got to go back, go into our wireless here, and looking for the Spark RC, connect, back out of that. And start update. Update complete. Wow, that was a quick little update. Please manually restart your remote controller. It said press OK, but it's saying there's still a progress on here. So obviously I don't want to restart the remote controller right now. Great job, DJI. Confucius. Absolute confusion. All right, so we're hearing some beeping and apparently it's still updating. Okay, 99%, is it going to complete? I hope something's gonna complete. There we go. We heard a long beep and update complete. Please manually restart your remote controller. Okay, so I don't know why I got that preemptive message. You saw that in the beginning. So I'm gonna press okay. It's saying 100% and we're gonna just go ahead and click and hold and then restart. So it really would be nice if there was a little bit more information on what to do, because people are gonna get super frustrated if they don't know what to do after restart controller. So I'm gonna go back, version check. Okay, so now it's collecting device info. So I'm just gonna let it do its thing for a while, see if it detects anything. Okay, so what I just did was I went back into my wireless and reconnected to the Spark RC because it was still stuck on my Wi-Fi network after it updated. So I did that, and then this is what it says. It actually went into the ability to go fly, and I got this message here. Your aircraft is flying in a different country region. We'll reset its wireless LAN setting in accordance to the local regulations. Please connect later. Don't know what that means, who knows? So probably what I wanna do is restart everything again, unfortunately, and see if something comes up. Now the lights on the Spark are blinking radically on the back, and I don't know what that means. So I don't know what to do. Should I restart it? What should I do? Still collecting device information. So far, I mean, geez, great tech. Awesome technology, but just a cluster of confusion here on updating and connecting between the RC, your smart device, and the Spark. So there we go. So now the lights are blinking on solid. So I'm going to reboot everything again and see if we can solve this. Okay guys, will we ever be able to fly this Spark? I don't know, but let's just try to connect again. So we're gonna go back to the beginning of how I connected at first. Power on the controller. Connect to the controller via the phone. Spark RC connected. All right, so now let's turn back on the Spark. I hope it's okay because it's really hot and this thing is running without flying for a long time. And here we go. So version check, RC connected, it's saying there on the left. I guess we should be able to enter device. So let's try now to enter device. I'm not seeing anything, any warning about updates. So hallelujah, we're connected, guys. Look at that. Okay, so apparently that firmware update did work. It was just stuck at 99% and I had to reboot everything. So a good indication of what you need to do if that happens in this video, if anything. Everything's normal. I'm not gonna calibrate anything at this time. And there we go. So we have our camera there on screen. Let's see how this stabilization is. Great stabilization. So it does not have a yaw stabilization on the gimbal, but look, it digitally actually does stabilize it somewhat. So you see that little bit of movement there, and the camera is actually not moving. If there's a little bit of shake, but it moves when you turn harder. So it should be great. Don't want to cover up these vent holes with my fingers because that's the way it cools itself down. Let's see if we go up and down. Great stabilization, look at that. Up and down, rolling. That's just great, okay. So that's gonna be some great stability even in this tiny little guy. So now we have ready to go GPS, and let's just take a look at the screen here before we get out there and fly. Showing us that we have 12 satellites. Our sensors are working. We've got 88% battery power. It's showing us our 5.8 gigahertz video Wi-Fi control here. This looks like our obstacle avoidance is working there. Now we have 14 satellites. GPS is locked. We have our camera picture mode and all the functions here, settings, which we'll go over in the flight test. Speed, our height from the launch point, our distance from the launch point. It's probably a little off. It says 8 feet because we're in the house, so the GPS isn't gonna be that great in the house. When we go outside, we should be getting around 20 satellites. And then all the basic DJI Go 4 information here. We have our launch, return to home, and the RC button, the way to control it. We have all our different functions here. Normal, quick shot, active track, gesture control, tripod, and tap fly. So I haven't seen the quick shot before. Looks like a new feature there. So there are a huge amount of features in the DJI Go 4 app. I'm not gonna go all through them here, but you see how I'm just clicking on, you can see the first person view of the camera and also your map. And then you're gonna have all of these features in here. These options here, you know, it's just basically you can change pretty much everything. So I guess this video, guys, is just gonna be kind of an unboxing setup and inspection of the craft. I think this is gonna be going a little bit too long to also include the whole flight test in this. This is an advanced craft and it's gonna require a lot more time on each function. So I think that's gonna wrap it up here, but basically, even though we had some negatives, some positives in this setup and unbox, you got to see firsthand how a seasoned flyer had a little bit of frustration on this setup. And I hope it kind of helps you, the problems I had to get through them, and it kind of informs you on what to do if you do have those problems. Like we saw that we were stuck at 99%, but for now I was able to connect the controller to the phone and then to the craft, and we're able to finish all the updates that way. I've got everything updated. So in the next video, which I'll have linked up here, I'll have the card pop up when that's done, and also down in the description you can check that out. I'll have the craft, what I'm using here, so you can check out the pricing and stuff, and also that flight test video when that's done. I want to take my time on this one because there's a lot of stuff to do and I want to make sure I have a thorough video here, so those of you who are really looking at this craft, I don't leave anything out, you know what I mean? I like to make my videos in-depth and thorough and really honest. So thanks for watching, guys, and I'll see you in the flight test.